That's us. 2nd Armored Division. Our boss, General Palmer. Quite an outfit. Tank, infantry, artillery, and engineer. Look pretty sharp, hmm? It's our last show in the States. We were alerted a couple of days ago. One of the new men, a joker, put an open letter on the bulletin board. A letter to Uncle Joe. Funny, history seems to repeat itself. About 10 years ago, there was another dictator named Adolf. He, too, thought he had the world in his pocket. I had just joined the 2nd then at Fort Benning. We were starting to organize. Don't ask me with what. Our guns were made of wood. When it came to tanks, we had to use our imagination. We couldn't kill a fly with the armor we had. But as supplies started pouring in, it began to look like the real thing. We were really training now. You heard of Georgie Patton? He was our CG. With him around, you just kept going. Brother, it looked as if the training would never end. Was he proud of us the way we came through those maneuvers in Louisiana and Carolina? We were a crack outfit now. They called us Hell on Wheels. Three invasion teams were picked from units of the 2nd and sent to Norfolk, Virginia. We practiced amphibious landings until water ran out of our ears. Soon enough, I found out why. We were going to be in on the African invasion. At 0400 on 8 November 1942, we hit the coast of Africa. Safi, Fedela, Port Leone. Our mission was to secure these ports and to envelop Casablanca. It looked a lot different from the movies. Nobody invited us to come to the Casbah. Old Georgie, who was the commander of the Western Task Force, ordered us to the French-Spanish-Morocco border in case there should be trouble. And then in April, we folded our tents and moved to Algeria, to a small town near Oran, where we started training for the next jump, Sicily. We were getting used to the water now. In fact, some of the GIs put in for sea pay. The traveler gets a friendly welcome as he arrives at its sunny shores. Sure enough, the Hermann Goering Division sent us a tank battalion as a special welcoming committee. But we knocked the H out of Hermann. The 14th and the 78th Field did a swell job there. Then we moved on. We advanced steadily over mined mountain roads that were blown off the cliffs, over tank traps, over blown bridges, through a lot of Italian towns that sounded like the menu of a spaghetti joint. Until we reached the end of the road, Palermo, the last dish on that Italian menu. After setting up the administration of the western part of the island, we took another boat ride. Arriving in England a short time later, the first combat-tested armor to hit Great Britain. There was something in the air. We knew the big show in France was about to pop, and we were going to be in it. We could almost smell it, because the training was stepped up. Because a lot of big boys came to visit us, even Mr. Great Britain himself. And then one morning in June, we were on the water, getting our last-minute briefing. The date was D-Day plus 3. Omaha Beach was a lot different from Omaha, Nebraska. I'll take Nebraska anytime. On D-Day plus 5, we were in it up to our necks, slugging it out with the Germans at Carentan. It was hedgerow country. Natural barriers 10 to 12 feet high that Jerry thought would stop us dead. Here's one time we threw the book away, used our tanks as battering rams. This was only the warm-up for the main event. The famous St. Lo breakthrough. Combat Command A, led by the 66, fought in the vicinity of Tessie-sur-Vire, securing the left shoulder of the opening. Seventh, meanwhile, spearheaded CCB's drive towards Sorrentes, cutting off the withdrawal of the Germans in that area. Old man Churchill was right. Sweat, blood, tears. Fighting, street by street, house to house, hand to hand. Jerry's reaction to our breakthrough was to counterattack in Mortain-Barrington area. But we smashed it. And how? We were picking up speed now. We started chasing Jerry to the Seine, taking thousands of prisoners. Pursuing him at an even faster pace toward the Somme, crossing the river at an unexpected point. Here was one time we caught him with his panzers down. On 2 September 1944, the first Allied elements, led by the 82nd Recon, rolled over Belgian soil. Driving across to the Dutch border, we bridged the Albert Canal, pushing north on a line through Sittard. Tanks of CCB under General White made the first crossing of Germany's holy soil on 18 September at Hillenburg. The holiness of the German fatherland became even more soiled when we crossed their border for the second time on October 3rd. It was like taking an obstacle course all over again, only this time it was the real thing and on Jerry's home ground. He was well dug in at the Siegfried Line, the famous impregnable West Wall. We went in after him. We were part of the Ninth Army. Combat Command B assisted in capturing Pallenberg, Ubach, while CCA moved to the south and took a couple of other south towns after heavy fighting. The rest of the division pushed southeast, meanwhile, and joined the First Army in a ring of steel around Aachen. Late in November, we resumed the offensive, moving further east and south. Town after town fell under the weight of our armor. But Jerry had still another trick up his sleeve. The famous Battle of the Bulge began. Last desperate effort of the German war machine. Adolf ordered his boys to do or die. There wasn't much time to lose. They had ripped our lines wide open at the Ardennes. We raced south to Cini in Belgium and tore into their 2nd Panzer Division. The 92nd Field was lifted up. We cut the westernmost prong of their assault wedge to pieces, destroying hundreds of their vehicles, including 81 tanks. Monty of Alamein wrote us a fan letter for this job. In Hoopalees, where the 41st did some of their heaviest fighting in snow and ice, we left a junkyard, German vehicle. We were sure tired when we met Patton's Third Army. Tired, but happy. It meant the western half of the bulge was sealed off. That phase of the campaign was over. After a short period of regrouping, we started the new offensive by crossing the Ruhr River. Goldenhausen, Kreppel, Erdingen. We never knew where Jerry was. Was he waiting behind that corner? Wherever he was, we hit him. We kept going until we reached the Rhine on 3 March 1945. That's where the 17th Engineers showed their stuff, bridging the river under fire in 7 hours. Breaking out of the Rhine bridgehead, we hit the Autobahn highway southwest of Beckum, cutting off Jerry's main artery of supply between Berlin and the Ruhr. At Lippstadt, we linked up with elements of the 3rd Armored Division, closing the trap on Germany's most vital industrial area. Jerry was losing his cockiness now. The attack rolled on, through the Teutoburger Forest, to the Weser River, onto the plains of North Germany. At Immendorf, the Hermann Goering Works fell into our hands. It was the beginning of the end for Jerry. On April 12th, we reached the Elbe. The Endstation, as they called it. We had overrun an area of 3,000 square miles, taken 45,000 prisoners, captured some big cities like Magdeburg. But the biggest was yet to come, Berlin. It was quite a feeling to march past the barracks of the Adolf Hitler Elite Guard. We were the 1st Division in Berlin. Our job was to provide security for the American sector of the city and furnish the honor guard for the Potsdam Conference. When President Truman arrived, we showed him that we were on the ball. From mud and dust, we were back to spit and polish, as if we hadn't done anything but parading these last 3 years. And then finally came that day in 45, when after two amphibious assaults, seven major campaigns, the outfit started on its way home. Proud possessor of the French Fourragère, the Belgian Fourragère, and 13 distinguished unit citations. Back in the States, we took up our peacetime duties at Fort Hood, Texas. A lot of men got out. New men came in. As the world situation grew tense, it was out of the barracks and into the field again. And now we're ready to go overseas. New weapons, new men, but with a fighting spirit that isn't new for this outfit. Ike sent for us. We always were his first team. Always will be. Hell on wheels. On wheels. That's us. 2nd Armored Division. Now, boss, General Palmer. quite an outfit. Tanks, infantry, artillery, and engineer. Don't ask me with what. Our guns were made of wood. When it came to tanks, we had to use our imagination. You couldn't kill a fly with the armor we had. But as supplies started pouring in, it began to look like the real thing. We were really training now. Fuzhou. Funny, history seemed to repeat itself. About 10 years ago, there was another dictator named Adolf. He, too, thought he had the world in his pocket. I had just joined the 2nd then at Fort Benning. We were starting to organize. You heard of Georgie Patton? He was our CG. With him around, you just kept going. Brother, it looked as if the training would never end. Was he proud of us the way we came through those maneuvers in Louisiana and Carolina? Looked pretty sharp, It's our last show in the States. We were alerted a couple of days ago. One of the new men, a joker, put an open letter on the bulletin board. A letter to Uncle